let's hope this works. Hey, all right. My name is Wayne Mitchell, this is my email, my contact information. You can see I'm a master of design, black and white. Because I've been to so many talks that I hate printing out colorful slideshows. And so it's easy to print out somehow, I can get this to you if you like. I've been around a long time. I started with mainframe computers. I started in computing when nobody had a computer because they just didn't make them yet. You never saw a computer you were working on. Personal computers came out. I got involved with the Boston Computer Society, and that's where you went to learn. You know, you didn't. They weren't teaching computers or any sort of science in college. You went there to learn, and I think one of the highlights was in 1984 when Steve Jobs introduced the Macintosh computer. He went on a nationwide trip. He came here to the East Coast first and showed it at John Hancock Building. And he gave out t-shirts. And I still have my t-shirt. I've got it sealed up in a little plastic bag. Hidden away so no one can steal it. I write a lot of code. I started with COBOL and Fortran. These days I'm working with something called Zojo, which is a cross-platform development environment. You write your code once, you compile it for Mac, Windows, Linux. They also have an iPhone compiler, and also for web apps. And they're working on a Droid, so it's going to be one development tool that you can build applications for any platform. Often my work integrates with websites. That's what brings me to website development. I do some community groups where they keep their community database I'm posted on their web server. I'll develop a client for that. See, I started working with CMS in 2004, and the first one I used was Mambo, which at that time was pretty good. And it was an award-winning software. It predates WordPress by a couple of years, even though there was something before that. There was some WordPress before that, but in 2005, the entire development team got up and quit. I had to find something new. They went to, they developed Joomla, which I used for a while. But it got me to my last point here. It's often not the software that you use, but the people that you partner with over the long haul, which is more important than the software. People come and go. And so the software products. It's good to stick with. I like open source. I like open source a lot. It's developed by a community of people. If one person leaves, someone else fills that spot. I try to use open source as much as I can, and the price is right. So tonight I'm going to just a little data strategies. As I began to develop this presentation, I expanded it a little bit to include a little bit on backing up your personal computer. We'll move on to backing up your website based on what your host offers you. Backup plugin, where it's a nice little feature plugin called Xcloner. Xcloner is an open source plugin, and I've used it for a few years. I like it. The guy who develops it is pretty good, keeps it up to date, and very responsive to any sort of inquiries. And the thing is that you want to automate as much as possible. You don't want to worry about the backups. I don't ever physically do a backup unless I'm migrating a site from a server to another server. That's the only time I actually do a backup. So just briefly, what I do, you've got to have something for a backup. I've seen so many people lose so much work. I'm a backup fanatic. I've been backing up since I had my first computer. I used to back up to 800K floppy disks, and I could back up everything I had on three of them. I got to be where I was using eight, and I would rotate three sets of eight 800K floppy disks. These days, I use Chronosync. And because I'm a developer, I want a copy of every version of every file that ever hits my computer. And I never empty the trash. If I put something in the trash, my backup the last step of my backup, and we'll empty the trash. So I get a copy of everything as it cycles through my computer. All my backups are bootable. If I have a crash of some sort, I can just go to another computer with a backup, start up, and I'm back in business. I don't have to download, and I'm backing up 300 gigabytes, I don't have to download 300 gigabytes over the internet to some new machine, which might take a long time. And I also use Mosey Home. There's a lot of good cloud backup sources out there. So starting with hosting backup, I use a host called Roken. They were a sponsor here at WordCamp a couple of years ago. I had a couple of bad experiences with hosting services. One was I had several sites on an account. One of the sites got hacked, but the hackers then could get into all my other sites. And everything on that server got compromised. So I want a host that protects every cPanel that I create. If one cPanel gets hacked, they can't get into the other cPanels. Another case I had was a company, some companies, they really don't host. They private label data centers. They buy their data center services. And this one company was doing just that. One day, it got so slow, it was unusable. I would type some characters, and it would take a few seconds for the characters to appear, to go to the server, come back on the screen, and it was unusable. And so I did some trace routing, and the company was out of Atlanta, and I found out how it got between me and the computer, and I found out that they claimed to be a few miles from my house. And I knew the address, and there was nothing there. And I don't know what they had there, maybe a router in a closet or something, I don't know. But, it's good to spend a little bit extra money and go with a good host. And there's a lot of good hosts. All our sponsors are good hosts. WordPress Engine is a top-notch host. A2 Hosting, Bluehost, Boldgrid, Rockin is good. They're all good, and they're all competing. They're all offering services to stay a little bit ahead of the other. And what I like with a host is to have automated backups and to be able to restore from backups. So everybody's heard of Uber, everybody knows Uber. I developed this website called Uber Reserve, and it was to reserve black car and SUV, where you're spending $4 a mile. So people don't often take that, but people do. There's a certain clientele out there. So I developed this website, and the reason I'm introducing it, because there was a rideshare company in Boston called Fastlane, and they only took 99 cents. Out of every dollar that the driver earned. And there was enough money in it so the drivers could go chase the workers. With Uber Reserve at $4 a mile, drivers are willing to drive from Logan out to Route 128 somewhere and make $120 or so to get back into the city. So I developed this website called Fast and Reserve, and then Fast and went out of business. So I've got this website here that we can trash them. Faster Reserve, here we are. Let's get into the cPanel. So this is a typical cPanel. They all use cPanel software. They all kind of look alike no matter what host you use. What I like about, so here we have some legacy backups. Over here, it's just a simple backup. Archives the files in your public HTML folder and archive your directory. But it's basic. It's a it's all manual. You gotta do the whole thing yourself. And all websites have that. Then you got a backup wizard, which will walk you through all the steps. And again, it's not really, you know, a robust system. I wouldn't call it a modern system. It's something that's been around a while. They all have. But what I like in most modern and good hosting services have is something called Restore Vault Backup. And this is a backup that they run every day or maybe multiple times per day. And here's a list of the latest backups that were run. April 30th, April 30th, they're running this every day. And it's very simple to select one and just restore it. Just restore it back down to my computer. In order to restore the database as well, I've got to send in a request and ask them to restore the database. They're having some issues with InnoDB tables on their database, so they do a manual. And another nice feature, and it's not really a backup, but it's a level of protection, and that's staging. This will create a subdomain, which will copy your site down to your subdomain. And then you can work on that, make changes, test plugins, and then push it back up. So let's create a little, just a little demonstration. Let's create a staging site. I'm just going to bring these down. Also, I'm going to put a password on there. And create a staging there. Pretty simple. And I'm going to go back to the slideshow and talk a little bit more about that. A lot of the configuration, I just took screenshots and have it on slides so we don't have to mess around with the going back and forth on the computer. So WordPress staging, and a lot of hosts have it. It's great for testing new plugins, plugin updates, new content, new design. And you can have multiple staging areas. So you can have staging 1, staging 2, staging 3, staging 4. You're only limited by your disk space. And like I say, it's just a click of a button. You just push it right up to your website when you're on. Yeah, these are the options that you have. A simple push just pushes everything up there. A advanced push, you can be more selective about what content you're putting up there. You got one site, you can duplicate it. It's pretty handy. Just another level of protection. When you mess things up, you got a way out. And I like to have a way out. Okay, so we're going to talk about Xploner tonight. Xploner is a plugin. It's developed by Ilyuda Ovidiu. I'm glad he's not here because I probably just butchered his name. He's lived in Romania. He's done a good job with this over the years. He's kept it up to date. Came up with a major upgrade about a year and a half or so ago. It's not complicated. And you can run this plugin on HTML. I've got a client with a couple of HTML sites. And so you can back up HTML sites as well. So, let's take a quick look back here. You can get the plugin off the plugin's website. you install the plug-in and you get these green bars on the right, that means you're good to go. Everything is configured properly. It's not hard to do. I don't think I did anything that was custom in the process of restoring it. You've got, look at that. You've got the dashboard and you've got several menus here for various features. First time I use this, this is a lot of fun. So rather than go through that, I did screenshots and I can just go through these. So it's not, I accept all the defaults. There's nothing special on any of these, on this config. My compression level is way down to the left. I'm not compressing anything because that takes time. My websites really aren't that big. The startup location is the top of my public HTML file, so I'm getting everything in there. It's going to put it in the backups directory. I have this enabled, which usually I'll turn that off. And this is kind of a nice feature. Every time you upgrade WordPress, it'll make a backup first. And it's got this feature down here. If you want to exclude files of some nature, you can do a regex and have it excluded. This is really straightforward. I just back up the MySQL tables. Often I have this turned on if I'm running some other database. I want to get all the databases off my site. This is standard localhost, my database username, and the name of the database. And I use, as you can see, I use fairly cryptic names for this sort of stuff. So system options, data size limit per request. Again, I just accept the defaults. I never have a problem otherwise. Data size limit, files to process per request, directories to scan per request, database records per request. Okay, and this is exclude files larger than zero. So zero is not 0 bytes, but zero is the default setting if you just want it to ignore that option. So I had a client one time that was installing disk images of Mac OS on their site, 2.5 gigabytes. I would exclude things like that. If someone was doing that, I would exclude file sizes bigger than, you know, to get some things like that. And I do have some pretty big websites, and I'll break the archive down into 2 gigabyte chunks. Cleanup options. This is pretty cool. So what this is going to do after 60, any backup that you make that's older than 60 days, it deletes it. Cleanup by quantity. So you could be doing 2 backups a day. So in 60 days, you would have 120. Well, with this set, it's only going to keep 100. It's going to get rid of backups after 100. And then if you have a certain capacity, size of backups that you, when you reach that, you don't want to do anymore, that's what you want to do. You can set a size. And usually if I, when I automate these backups, I'll have it delete the file after it goes up to the cloud. Okay, so if I'm doing something on the cloud, and I use Amazon S3, I'll keep my backup for 1 day. A lot of my backups are going to kick off the first of the month. So tomorrow I'm going to get a lot of emails that my backups have kicked off. The day after, it's going to start deleting these archives. I heard once that having a backup on your server is like leaving the front key of your house under your front doormat. Now, I don't know how true that is. But scared me, so I get rid of my backups. I don't leave any backups on my server. After 1 backup, it deletes it. scanner. This is my configuration for S3. Okay, Amazon Web Services, you get it free for a year. You go sign up, and you'll get it free for 1 year. I've had it for over a year, and my backup costs me $1 a month. All the stuff I've got on my S3, and it's only costing me $1 a month. It's a good deal. I use S3, which stands for Simple Storage Service. Very expensive, and it's a little bit difficult and tricky to set up, mostly for configuring your security and your identity and your access. It's a little bit cryptic. Took a little work. This is the front panel, the dashboard for Amazon S3. You can see it's kind of, you know, it's got these not very friendly URLs. Here, you can see that I've got this warning triangle because I do not have multi-factor authentication in use here. And that's because last summer, my phone crapped out on me and I had to restore from a backup. I backed up my phone too. And for whatever reason, it wouldn't, my Google Authenticator wouldn't work anymore because I didn't know what the MAC address of the phone was. I don't know why, but it wouldn't work anymore. And I couldn't get into it. So I did call them and they're very responsive. I called them up, I explained to them, went through a couple things, they sent me an email, they called my home phone just to verify my identity, and they got me running again. But because of that, I decided to not activate multi-factor authentication. And you have to have, you see I've got two users, two groups, and one role. And that is what you need to set up. Setting up, and you go on the story, you go to your dashboard, you start with a group, you create a user, define a role, and then set a policy. You've got to set a policy for it. And the policy is what gets you. This is a list of policies. And you can see there's 371 of them, all in alphabetical order. In this case, I sorted the list by checkbox. And there's only three. Actually, this is for a database server. So you don't need to use that for S3. This one, I believe, gets created almost automatically when you create your first user. But this is the one, Amazon S3 Full Access. You've got to create that and assign it to a user. So that's the hard part. Once you get that, that's the hard part. And you're on your way. You don't think about it anymore. Okay, so then you set up remote storage. You get a S3 will give you a key and a secret word. You should put that in wherever it is you use to store your passwords. Put the secret key in there because you'll never get it again. You can get a new one, but you will never get that exact one again. So they'll give you these keys, the S3 key. You can get the S3 key, but the S3 secret is a one-time deal. So it's just a hassle. You know, you can sort through it, you gotta get another secret, and then you gotta enter it in all your accounts, and it's just kind of a pain. And I created a bucket for tonight called the WP Meetup Demo Bucket, and that is what we'll deposit our backup into. And at the very last S3 cleanup, 730, that's 2 years. That's 2 years of backups. After 2 years, it's going to start cycling those backups off and deleting them. Well, it looks like I killed the battery on this. Jeez. I need a backup battery. Anybody got one? So, so when you go to configure Xplorer and you go to schedule backups, you're going to get this warning that you have disabled WP Chrome. And you need to fix that. And you click on that button that says here, and that will take you So you go to your WP config file, and you add one line right here, number 42. It's just a copy and paste thing. And I always add a comment whenever I change these files. I make sure I add a comment, edit by Dwayne to Chrome Jobs, and I put the date in. So if somebody else picks up this website or wants to work on it, they know where that came from and they know what the purpose is. So manage backups, another panel there, the red dot that you see on the left is just a disclosure button. You click that and it will compress those lines. It tells you the backup name, date, size, and then at the bottom you have several options. You can click the down arrow and it will download it. The up arrow will cloud, which will put it to S3, put it up to S3, and it's very fast. You know, I just recently did an 8 gigabyte website, and it's like that. It's just going co-location to co-location. And you can put a folder, you can browse what's in the archive, the trash can, you can delete it. And one thing I wanted to point in the top right-hand corner, you can also browse your remote storage. You can browse your cloud. So in this case, I've changed that to S3, and that is the archives that I have on S3. Here's what a scheduled backup looks like. I was properly configured. This is going to run, I generally run these things once a month. Remote storage is AWS, that's where it's going. The status tells you that's ready to go. And if I want to change it, I want to edit it for any reason, I can do that. Generating backups, fairly straightforward. Backup name, notification, and I like getting the notifications. If I don't get a notification when I expect it, like tomorrow, I'm expecting to get a bunch of them. And I'll compare them to my list of sites, and if I don't get one, then generally something's wrong somewhere. You include the databases that you want. Normally it's just one. You never have to include the information schema. You don't need to include that. Files. I exclude. These are files that you want to exclude. So I don't use any CGI scripts, so I exclude the CGI bin. That's going to get created on most hosts anyway, and it's empty. Also, the dot well known, I don't even know what that is. It's a new, something new on hosts. And then you're good to go, hit the button. Hit the button and you make your backup, and everything's happy. Now, if you want to save what you just did as a scheduled script, scheduled backup, you fill it out here, and then you save it. And I created a couple. You know, because my host backs up every day, I really don't need to mess with this. I like archiving once a month my client sites, they're offline somewhere. So here we are at restore. Normally when I restore from, if I got something messed up, it's messed up good. You know, then I just wipe it out. Delete the databases, wipe out all the files, and restore from an archive. But what I do is I upload the archive to my hosting service. There's a couple of scripts that you add. You type in the URL, and it kicks off the backup, the restore process. Sometimes I heard of people who will install a fresh copy of WordPress. They will install Explorer and then use this feature to restore their backup. You set the target path, the top directory of your website file system. You include the backup and it works. It works. So this is the Amazon S3. That's what it looks like. So you create a bucket. And it just stores the files. It's nothing complicated. Except for setting it up. Okay. Well, that's my presentation. Let me do a little demonstration. I think I got a couple minutes left here. Let's test fate on this. Let's come over here to File Manager. So I've deleted the database and I've deleted the all the files. So we're a big troll. Good thing we got a good host. So let's go to the restore vault. As I said, this is a popular feature on a lot of hosting services. I'm going to restore from the backup that was made this morning. Click on that. Then this is the entire home folder. This is everything, including a lot of files and folders that I don't want. And the only thing I do want this site. interested in. I've always found this company to be very responsive. So, does anybody have any questions while we're giving them comments?
What about just our contract or account?
The same thing, yeah, backup buddy is another one.
Is that still there?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how it compares to this. I don't know if it's any more or less complicated, but.
Or less.
Less, yeah. Yeah. Is that a paid plugin?
Yeah, there is a paid version.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm just into open source. I tend to go with things that look a little bit harder. I like to know how they work. I've been doing this a long time, like I said. It's all part of the fun, part of the adventure. Anybody else?
I was just wondering, have you ever deleted something and then not had a backup, or maybe the backup wasn't saved properly, or how did you recover?
Well,
did you always have a backup?
Well, I always have had a backup. I'm pretty good about it. I've had disasters. I've had a few, and usually it's just a bunch of files that I delete by mistake. But I have had hardware failures. I also had clients that have deleted things. And usually there's software that will read the actual sectors on the disk. Or, in this case, the SSD. That's the only way you can get it. If you have something on a web server or someone else's server, you're kind of at their mercy to recover. So, there's a company here, I think you guys are Cambridge or a Wall fan, but they do some really hardcore data recovery. They made their name when they reconstructed a hard drive that was part of a bomb in a laptop. And they were able to reconstruct enough of it to get evidence to present in court. I forget, they used to advertise on NPR. You're almost never really out of business, but it's going to cost a lot of money. So, thank you very much.